Grace, as Schwint is an artist living in London, but at the moment about to have a show, as Jill said, of this incredibly interesting piece, which we're going to talk a little bit about, I hope, since it's the one that's opening and has been showing, it's traveling around at the moment. But this is now your chance, so welcome and thank you very much for coming from Glasgow, hot from putting it in to talk to us and to explore what you are going to be thinking about with the pavilion, but also with Carolyn Christophe Bakagia for the Istanbul Biennale. So.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me, first of all. So I think I will just talk about the project that I will do for the Istanbul Biennale, and then maybe later we can talk about other works. So the project, it's actually a kind of really big project that takes different forms, and I've been working on it for a while now, kind of a slow development, and then, yeah, with Jill and Will, we started to make it more concrete in the, I don't know, last half a year or something. So basically, it's an opera, but I use that word very loosely. So I made some notes because it's a really complex project. So it starts with a relationship between capitalism and morality, and different levels of distancing, which I will go into. I actually have an interest in using the sea as a kind of means to talk about capitalism for many years. I started to look into this like in 2008 or something. So I'm interested in this idea of a fantasy of capitalism and of an idea that capitalism can be a platform to have this idea of togetherness and connectedness, throughout the whole world. And maybe that connects a bit to this idea, what you said, this international art world kind of hovering. So on one hand, it's this idea that, through maybe quite an arrogant idea, through thinking that through a mouse click, on a computer, you kind of connect it to the rest of the world. And also this kind of social, social media activism, which, I find kind of disgusting, of making a comment, let's say on Facebook, and then people like it, and I don't know, yeah. So this is all connected to this kind of mouse click, and in fact, 90. So one thing is that 95% of the goods, for example, in the UK, are still transported via the sea, with like heavy vessels, slow vessels, a lot of workers, and. In fact, their injuries that occur because of the working conditions and their death, so the dead body is calculated in the profit. So when we started to research to do research about Shetland Islands and the oil industry, it was very, very interesting. I started to talk to someone when I was still in London, and he was talking about this, he basically said workers don't really die, which is not true. And but then when I kind of asked more and he spoke about it more, it was like the dead body of the worker was completely abstract thing that happens, but of course it happens and it's kind of okay that it happens. It just has to be hidden because otherwise people don't like it, don't like the company anymore, and then it would influence the profit that they make. That's one thing. And then, I started to read about this idea of morality. Morality is almost like, became like a commodity. And this is also connected to that, it used to be much more regulated through law, how corporations can operate. So laws regulated through governments. So laws were put in place, and then corporations had to answer that. Otherwise, they've been, tried. So now in recent years there was a huge kind of development in Brussels, that more and more morality, more and more corporations have a very free interpretation of regulations, basically. So they're not laws anymore, they're regulations. And so it's very freely interpreted, and then, of course, to make maximum profit. And I find it interesting to think about morality as a commodity, because, you know, these companies have there's companies that are founded to, you know, create an image of a corporation that presents that they care about the environment, they care about the people, they care about the workers. And, you know, we saw this, also in this research in Shetland Island. So, and there's slogans like clean water, you know, the waters in Shetland Islands, they're clean, they're super clean. The fish is very healthy, and there's no, the oil just disappeared. You know, also the species almost all survived, except three bird species all died out completely. So it's of course, it's not true that the waters are completely clean. But of course, if the waters wouldn't be completely clean, then fish, you know, fishing industry wouldn't sell. At the moment, the waters are actually apparently clean. So that's, I don't really care about that. What I care about is that there's a whole industry developing around this idea that companies need to, you know, commodify this idea of morality, which that's kind of my interest. And I went to Shetland Islands to interview different people from really from council to fishermen to oil tanker pilots to I don't know, lots of different people. And there was this one man that is just a really fantastic person, and he's a bird watcher, and he has his office in a lighthouse where I will film, this is one part of this uprise that it will be a film, and that will be filmed in this lighthouse, or in this area around the lighthouse. And his job, who does he work for? The council? Or?
Simba Environmental Action.
Yeah. Okay, so he since 37 years, he does, maybe I'm slightly romanticizing, distorting facts, but that will be kind of the narrative of this work, is that he does the same route since 37 years, along the beach, all the way down, all the way to the BP fence, and looks for birds and checks if they have any remnants of oil. And then this goes sent to a lab, and then they check where the oil comes from. And then they put pressure on BP or on other oil tankers that are in this northern Red Sea, in the waters. Often it can't be traced back, or it's too vague, and so on. But at one occasion, he actually started a huge court case against BP, where they paid, I don't know how much, but it was quite a big deal, because he found this dead bird. And so he's one thing is that for me it's really useful, him talking about these dead bodies that he finds, because my work is very much, surrounds always this idea of this fragile body. So I was talking about the worker's body also, and this idea that actually, and also health and wellness, and that, you know, in fact, our bodies are so fragile that even if I take a knife, it's immediately open. We're so fragile and kind of maintain these healthy bodies to, in fact, also to produce capital, because we are part of a capitalist system, you know, whether we like it or not. So he talks about these birds, how he finds these birds and these bird parts, sometimes they're just parts. And I find it really fascinating, this material of the feathers and the oil and him finding these different parts, and he speaks about them he completely loves birds. You know, he dedicates his life to these birds. But on the other hand, he's completely not sentimental about it, really matter of fact. And then I thought of this, sorry to do this kind of quoting, but this Hegelian approach of saying that to unite, I mean, he said like the philosopher who makes sense is the one who puts, you know, kind of unites reason and love and concept. And so I think like there's a lot of these ideas that I wanted to work with in this talk from this bird watcher. So it will be basically this, the language. So it's, I don't know if you know my work at all, because should I assume not, or no? Okay. So I used so it's always the idea that I take a system apart when I make a work, and so in the film that you mentioned briefly, like or in other works also, I use language in this very stripped down version because I have a strong resistance to. To authorship, to the idea of the witness, to the idea of authority, of kind of making you want, you know, making you fall in love with my, with the performers, or wanting or hating them, and like I, you know, this idea of how narratives has been created conventionally, I want to kind of destroy. or distract, and so the idea with language, I was like, okay, I want people to speak texts, and I'm really interested in interviews and in social relations and human relations. But so I have this very stripped down version of how people speak, so without any emotions, and the direction is to say, I work with dancers, by the way, not actors, to say that every word is spoken the same way, like chair, terrorism, tree, water, and so on. And now with this new work, I'm really interested in like when language kind of hits an end, and what happens before and after language, and I'm using the voice for that, and this relationship with the voice, and also this different ideas of what's in the voice and what's in language. So this idea that voice perhaps can be something that's stripped of gender and class and weight and height of a person, and that becomes part of being able to identify with language, even with like just saying vowels. Like, so I'm interested in like what a voice also can do when they go really high, so and really low, when it comes almost to just a vibration. And that's all connected to thinking about how to use narrative, like how to create a narrative, or how a narrative has been created, and how I kind of want to work with that. And so So my other background is that I come from classical music, so I've been trained as a pianist for quite a few years, 15 years. And I started thinking more and more about the voice. I started to work with these opera singers in London, and they're like a group, or I work with two of them, they're transgender opera singers, and they're creating this music that questions opera, but also finds ways to move between different sounds and voices from a very philosophical and political perspective, and trying to think of a space that can possibly be created through opera, which is trans space and trans gender and trans class and trans everything. Being aware that trans is of course also loaded, but like kind of almost going through it. And what the idea is, why we work together, is that I wanted to use voice for talking about that. And opera is for me also very interesting, because it always used this idea of disguise, for example, it has a very interesting idea of the female. So there's different ideas about it. So one, thing was that if a female singer only really has a right to be on stage if she is disguised as a man at some point in the opera. That was one interpretation. But then other interpretations are that actually the female in Mozart's operas play always the key role, the key actor who, like, you know, kind of from the narrative, always kind of conclude things, always make things possible. But there's a lot of ideas of like a female voice being written for a female performer being dressed as a man performing a female and so on. So there's a lot of, and also the whole idea of disguise was an entertainment for like 100 years. It was, you know, funny to have a servant and a master exchanging clothes and then by that exchanging status somehow. Like that's, it's funny, you know. I mean, it was funny, it was like on Marketplace, it was performed. And the same with gender. So I'm kind of looking at finding that also useful to think about opera, the history of opera in that way. And another thing that kind of came up recently was that Heidegger came to England and organized these parties where people were in disguise. You can see whether they what gender they are and also not what class they are. So it was a completely mixed. And then how they were allowed to communicate was like through this kind of bird. Of course, I'm totally in love with this idea now. With this, like bird noises, you know, this like tweaking, instead of using language. But it was basically to meet someone to have sex, you know. So it was like this parties were organized for that, you know, to meet and actually physically engage. So then you didn't know who you're engaging with, but then you kind of, you know, had to do it. So I'm kind of looking at lots of different ideas of mask, you know, disguise and masquerade, and how language defines, kind of creates categories, but maybe also whether it's possible to kind of pull it out of that through this voice. So these opera singers, they will move really fast from like high pitched sounds, which sound like animal sounds, to a very operatic melody, to this vibration where you don't really know where it comes from in the body. So I will have some live elements also in another exhibition later on, where I want to have live, the opera singers live, that the audience can go really close and kind of can check where this vibration comes from, because it seems to come from here, but you know, and then the other thing, maybe this is too much of a jump, but I quite like to bring it in anyways. I spoke to someone yesterday about this this kind of idea of the virtual and the material, and for me it's really important in my work that I try to turn everything into material in order to, that the thing itself can take responsibility for what it does. So the voice I want to turn into material so I can look at it and kind of analyze it and explore it and take it apart and so on and so forth. So, or I use the word also sculptural sometimes. And then the idea was that actually there is, the virtual doesn't exist because, which I didn't know, which I find lovely, is the idea that the internet, the entire internet, is as heavy as one strawberry. I don't know if you knew that. I didn't know that. So it actually has a weight because you can kind of measure weights and so on, like a tiny, tiny bit, but like, you know, as tiny as the whole internet weighing like a strawberry. So that's the only reason I mentioned this, because of my constant attempt to turn everything into material, to turn a movement into material and so on and so forth. And the other thing with a voice is that I'm very interested in this difference or the relationship, which actually also relates to old sculptures, this idea of whether a voice, you know, whether making a voice of the difference to communicate to someone, let's say, asking for help, or telling you I'm in pain, or kind of these extrema impacts to having an just a expression of mental or physical impact. So like a, you know, scream that just comes out of you because of an impact, rather than having a direct message to someone. So this also I want to play with really in the opera with the sounds. And it's, you know, to have that sometimes that noise to communicate something and let's say trigger some movement in another performer, or sometimes to go and, you know, to just disappear. But then of course not disappear, because then it becomes really heavy if there's no reaction to it. So maybe now I come more concrete to the Istanbul Biennale work. So I've been like working on this for a while, and then we started to talk, and then it was like, oh, this is actually really a perfect match to the idea of the Istanbul Biennale. So then quite a lot of dialogue developed, and yeah, it was really, really interesting, and different ideas kind of came, but I had to think of an idea, you know, what is possible and kind of makes sense for the Biennale. And so what I'm doing now is that I'm developing with this opera singers, I'm developing, and also I go to interview this lovely bird watcher, and then I also want to record some sounds, some specific sounds that relate to also later the choreography of the dancers and so on. So to create a sound piece and work with some other objects, some other objects. And also the idea of salt. So that's the other thing I want to talk about before I stop talking and before we start talking. So salt I use in other works as well. And for me, it represents different things. So one thing it represents for me is this, because a lot of my work is about a desire for immortality, you know, and a pretense that we cannot die, and how that's also kind of sold and used in capitalism. So the idea with salt I find useful because it preserves, but it actually only preserves the dead body. You know, because if you would drink it, you would die. So it kills the life body, but and it preserves the dead body, which I think is great. But so I want to use that idea. But of course, we also need salt to survive. And as you pointed out, we have a lot of salt in our bodies already, and water. I'm interested in these different implications. It's quite an aggressive material, I think. And then the other thing which I worked with before with this idea of salt is also that it's used for cooking, of course, and if in the domestic environment. So for me, it has also always this domestic connotations, which I use a lot in my work, the family house, and this is now a huge jump, but. So for me, it's a very useful material to think about. So I will use that also in this installation in relationship to this voice. I want to bring together basically this material of salt and the desire to preserve and this voice and this connection to death and life, yeah, but death mainly. And of course, then the connection, which was from the beginning a really important part of the conversation, was with Caroline, was that the idea of that the oil industry and basically the Northern Sea route being a new route, being a really important route for oil and gas coming from Asia to Europe and America, which is not quite usable yet, but luckily we have global warming and all this ice is melting. So now, you know, we don't need icebreakers soon anymore. And the problem, and Russia is controlling it at the moment because they have icebreakers as part of their military equipment. And you can't, I mean, recently UK actually invested huge amounts of money in an icebreaker, which is very suspicious. But they, so Russia is controlling it through these icebreakers, and it costs like billions to run, basically. You know, you can't just have an icebreaker. And you need the icebreakers to lead the ships through the Northern Sea Route. So this was a lot of the discussion that, you know, the other main sea route goes through Turkey for oil and gas. So, and that's also connected, but this maybe puts another big, opens another huge subject, is the Ukraine conflict and, you know, control of ports and so on and so forth. So that was also the other connection. So the sea is, the salt is also connected to the sea because it's sea salt, yeah. That's it. Oops.
Do you have any images
there? Oh, I have images, yeah, I forgot. These are, I thought to just show you some, this is actually used for the catalogue of the Istanbul Biennale. So these are costume designs from the film, from the project. So I will work with ballet, obviously I work with ballet, with dance. So maybe we can speak about dance a bit also, I don't know. And I use, this is not an unusual costume, I would say, for me. But and then this is, so then also one thing which was really lovely, Shetland Islands, we met these women that were left behind because somehow no women are involved in the fishing industry, by the way, but all ships and vessels and boats are called she. But so the women were left behind on the Shetland Islands, or left behind, I don't know, they didn't go fishing. And but what they did was knitting. So they knitted these wonderful patterns, and we visited one woman who's now, I don't know, in her 80s, I guess, and she's knitting since she's 3 years old, you know, and her skills are just mind-blowing, of course. So I want her, I hope she will manage, you have to organize this, that she will knit this long costume. So I was also looking at knit. I used knitting a lot in my previous works, also in some previous works. So this is a performer going up this hill and then rolling down and so on and so forth. So these are kind of like moments of the choreography. And then this performer here has some paint on them, like kind of shapes of a cow. It's a bit out of context and sounds a bit strange probably now. But and then this one, so the lighthouse is a really interesting building actually. It has, am I still on time or? Yeah, so there's the lighthouse, and then it's like very traumatic, of course, at the end of a cliff and loads of wind and so on and so forth. And it has buildings like an old radar system from the Second World War, where they actually discovered that there were German bombers, 50 of them, trying to destroy the depot for the weapons, the British weapon depot. So they came and wanted to destroy that, and someone in this lighthouse saw it, and then they shot them down, and they couldn't destroy the, but you know, maybe, well, that's the story anyway. So there are these buildings. Then there's like a kind of Roman column somewhere in the landscape, and then there's these kind of holiday houses and this corridor, which almost looks like in a Western or something. So I want to use all this architecture, and I also want to make costumes for the architecture. And I often do that I want to kind of turn a costume in the film or in the performance, a costume becomes a prop becomes a set, or a set becomes a prop or a costume. So the bodies are always very much directly connected to the space in a very physical way. And there was also what I mentioned earlier in this other piece that I did at Badische Kunstverein with the salt, where the dancer always, her movement was directed towards the architecture that was there. So here it's a long corridor. And then, so this is, I work with silk a lot because of the weight and the movement and the colors and the and so on. So the it connects from the top of the building to the dancers, and yeah, so they make these different shapes together as a community. So there will be also a lot of movement between the community and the communal, the community, the group and the individual, and it moves kind of in and out. And there will be also a community orchestra, but that will come later. Yeah, that's it.
Thank you. Okay. Are there any immediate questions anybody wants to put to Grace to what she's actually talked about so far? Yep.
How do the images you've shown us relate to what you said before?
How do
the images you relate to what you were saying before?
Okay. They relate in as much as they are the costume designs for the opera, for the film, so for the initial project. And so what I was talking about before was more the concept and all the ideas behind it. And then I kind of made a huge jump to the Istanbul Biennale rather than talking about the whole film or the whole opera, because for the Istanbul Biennale I would kind of develop almost an independent work, but that relates to to this bigger production. So basically these are images of the, so in the film that I will shoot at the Lighthouse in Shetland Islands, I will use the sound from the Istanbul Biennale that I will use there will be part of that. So that's the kind of performance of the opera singers there. In addition to that, I will also have dancers and a lot of choreography. So it's a very, I work very, very, very visually also. So Istanbul will be based on the sound, and that was also from the beginning part of this whole production, was that Jill mentioned it in the beginning, that it will be a sound, just a transfer of just the sound, like a live transmission just of the sound. So I did this before, so this idea that kind of, that's also one idea of distancing, that you listen to the sound and imagine what happens at this island. So, and that's connected to also this distancing from the ships that are traveling slowly and heavily over months, and the communication between the land and the sea, which is why I want to use a lighthouse, because it's a visual communication. So the costumes, I thought to just put it in a context that you understand the kind of visual element, and I put it also in the catalog because I want to create a fantasy of that space. Yeah.
Can I just talk a little bit more about that? So it's going to be a live transmission from the performance in Shetland to Istanbul.
It's basically almost, you can imagine this now as like almost like a library or something of, mm-hmm. It's became this really big project. So the first element will be this. I will focus on the development of the voice and this relationship to language and the voice, which is what I was expanding on, because that's the kind of most important thing that I'm working on at the moment for in dialogue with the Istanbul Biennale. So that's one part, and that will be presented in conjunction with these materials such as salt. And then I will be actually in Shetland Islands working on like rehearsing and working on developing the opera, including the dance choreography, working with a community orchestra, and then I also have some performers, like the oil, he doesn't know that yet, but a captain or pilot from an oil tanker will also perform, and the bird watcher, of course. So I have these different people that will perform also visually then. So, and then this live, this opera that will be performed with the camera. So the camera is always also very choreographed in my work. So that will be live transmitted to different institutions.
That's interesting, because I mean that, you know, the idea of having slowness, materiality and slowness, and then the live transmission, which is the sound travels quickly, doesn't it?
It travels pretty quickly, yeah.
Yeah, so that's really nice though, isn't it? Because all the sort of physical effort and the materiality, your dancers, your choreographers and the physical thing, and then it seems to be a metaphor for what you're saying about the speed of the tanker, the slowness of the tanker, and the materiality of all that stuff you're working with. And then you make it into sound which goes zip, which is just lovely. I mean, that's... And you're not doing it on the internet. Are you doing it on the internet, the sound? How are you transmitting the sound?
How are we transmitting the sound?
It would use the internet.
I was going to say, because yeah. Seems to me to be really important about the manner, the material manner in which the sound gets transmitted. If you're doing this kind of thing.
Yeah. We have to use the internet, basically. I mean, the other possibility would be to use the telephone line.
Yeah, I've seen that.
Yeah, and that's what we did in Leeds before, you know, at the Picture House, when it was like a telephone line between the theatre and where the performance took place and the cinema. But in this case, because a lot gets lost, you know, it's like a totally reduced... So in this work for the Istanbul Biennale, I found it really important that you have these different layers of sound. So there will be also movement sound, and then I want to record movement in the grass, actually, where the dancers step on and so on and so forth. So there's like all these different layers and the mechanical sounds of the lighthouse. And so, and the internet is, of course, also nice to use in this whole concept, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Can I show the little sideline to what you were talking about, the idea of salt and its preservation and, you know, its dangerous nature? I went to Gujarat and went to the salt flats in Bhuj, where Gandhi set out from to walk to the sea to do his salt thing. He could have actually got salt there, but it was much more dramatic to actually make the journey longer and get more press. Anyhow, and it was a really nice romantic tale. And then I was talking to somebody who was working with the people in the salt flats, who the men by the age of 30, because they work up to their knees in the salt, their legs are destroyed.
Wow, yeah.
And he was working with the orphans from these families to provide them with a living. And it was this complete contrast that just hit home to me.
Well, yeah, that's interesting.
The way that the industry works, and so yes, that contradiction between salt being necessary and salt being destructive is quite poignant.
It's interesting, and it's probably almost in every industry you have these hidden dead bodies, you know.
Yes.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, I want to just pick up on that, because I mean the thing with salt, it goes on and on. The word salary comes from salt because it was such an incredibly valuable material that it was one of the first currencies,
yeah.
And that people were paid in salt, or, you know, people being called worth their salt. You know, all these phrases that we have which remind us that, as I think you're saying, that the power of it for flavouring, also for preservation. Also, I mean, in Spain, you cook in these great mounds of salt. It becomes a kind of its own form of automatic oven in a kind of way when you put the fish into that. So there's this kind of trace in our history, but also, as you say, it's extraordinary because it's sodium chloride, so it's a very powerful chemical in that kind of density. And then, obviously, if you have more of it, I mean, the salinity of different seas, so you rise up with the Dead Sea, sort of, you know, sufficiently like that. And I think the Bosphorus is about 35%, so it's actually a very, very salty sea in that sort of way, so that would be itself extraordinary to be, I mean, and presumably the great salt flats all around Turkey, and I mean all the way through Greece. I visited some in Sicily, where was I recently? Sicily has got some beautiful examples. So it's part and parcel of the whole history of the Mediterranean, where you use the coastalness to that. The other thing I want to pick up, which I think with when you mentioned the knitting, that the origin of all the different designs of Shetland and Fair Isle is that each knitter knitted a specific design. So
exactly,
when their husbands drowned, you would know who the body was. That's why the designs, everybody had their own design. So there's a very interesting relationship between those two things in terms of you're saying about the risks, the bodies that are part and parcel of working.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And she was, I mean, she didn't, the woman that we met, she didn't talk about that, but she talked a lot about patterns. And,
yeah, but that was what I was told was from the origin of the diversity, was that there were, you could tell which family it belonged to, that these were very distinctive and why they're so various rather than repetitious things.
Yeah.
I just wanted to pick up, maybe we talk a bit about that aspect, because it fits into two elements of Karen Kristoff's thinking and that what I'm beginning to try and make sense of for myself, but the question of the visible and the invisible. And you linked the, as it were, the kind of making invisible of the risk to the precarious, I mean, to the fragile body of labour.
Mm-hmm.
And of the labouring body, and then of course we have the imagined sense of the circulation of the value, which then capital takes from us. So this question goes right back to sort of the beginning of kind of Marx's idea of what is the problematic of the world we live in, of what actually is the producing, and the price of the work of producing becomes invisible and disappears into the commodity. So when you made the point then about the fact that this whole new movement for corporate responsibility, the idea of commodifying morality as a part of the calculating of the costs involved on the basis of profit. What fascinates me is that clearly we can now, I mean, you can talk about capitalism. I mean, when I started teaching, if you mentioned capitalism, everybody knew you were a Marxist, because only Marxists named the system.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas what we've got is a system here, which is we name it, but it no longer frightens people. It's just a description. We no longer have that sense of what was involved in it. And so I was interested because the major piece, you know, that you've made that's in Glasgow, that was in Sheffield, concerns this long conversation that you're having with an activist from Germany in the 1970s. And I was trying to explain to my own students recently, and even sort of calculating, you know, that we've forgotten that there was intense urban terrorism produced by a generation in Italy and Germany in revolt and revulsion from the fascist legacies of both those countries. At that time, which took the form of, you know, intense political activism and the form of violence. Whereas we live in an age now where we've, you know, the concept of the terrorist is not the Bader-Meinhof or, you know, the Red Brigade or the Red Faction. I mean, which is the fraction, which, I mean, I can't remember the Italians. But now we've sort of, it's located in this different space of what is being presented to us as religious wars rather than class wars, even while there clearly are ways in which we can understand various sorts of elements of it. But what is interesting, you'll see where this is going in 1 minute. One of my colleagues at university, Jane Taylor, when we were just trying to discuss this, and she was saying, okay, so if we accept the sense that there is alienation, and what is the problem is not that you're dying from work, but you're dying to have work, right? And the refugees coming across from Libya are people from Africa who went to work in the industries of Libya, and because Libya's fallen apart, they have no work, they're searching. So they are definitely dying for work, right? But if I just finish one more bit, but in fact, the people who are going off, in fact, to become part of ISIS and all these other sorts of things, if we have an analysis that somehow here we have people who are alienated from our societies, can't find themselves, there was a point, not 10, 15 years ago, where if you felt that, you would turn to crime, or you'd go into the drug trade in order to kind of get the money to be part of the commodity. What you wanted was the trainers, the cars, you know, you wanted access to commodity society. Whereas what is so curious now is, why don't people want trainers, right? But they want guns to kill people. Something very, very curious has happened in terms of one group of people dying in the Mediterranean, drowning in the salt water of the Mediterranean in, as they die for work and will do all sorts of horrible things, which we then eat our lettuce and our courgettes and our red peppers because they're the ones who are growing them. And yet on the other hand, there's also this other aspect of people alienated, you know, it's another kind of form of class dissociation and confusion, which is turned to a different kind of violence. Right, so I just thought it was very interesting. Maybe you could say something about where you are in terms of your formation and going back to this conversation in the 70s, but now clearly struggling to find a way, not, I don't mean struggling in a bad sense, I mean negotiating, struggling positively. How do we hold some of these kinds of things together, what you know about the shipping industry, what we know about oil, what we know about its environmental effects, what we know about communities. And yet, what we, even as you say them, the knowing isn't connected enough affectively. And I wondered if that's why you, the relationship between what you've set up conceptually and having, you know, wanting to use the dancing, the body, a very specific kind of body, choreography, places, spaces, sounds, because these are very, very visceral that you're talking about, really being grounded in something that is about the body. And what kinds of languages can artists find today to, you know, to pierce us in some sense with something which has become, you know, so to say, we can talk about capitalism, but it doesn't convey what, you know, let's say your taxi driver in the 50s, in the 70s, you know, is this was a real war, right? We do have a real war now, but it doesn't seem to be about that, and yet they must be related. And yet one has to say that the man from ISIS, as it were, the finance director of ISIS, who's now in prison, said they will never run out of money, right, for two reasons. A, they've got access to billions of dollars of oil money, and B, through kidnap ransoms. That's their major source of income.
Different thoughts come up. One was the first thing that you talked about, morality, and what came to my mind, which is kind of the paradox, I guess, is that the higher the profile of a company, of a corporation, to be moral and to care, the more kind of the more dead bodies they can produce, you know, because and the more environmental damage they can produce, because so it's quite interesting. Like once a company is believed to care, they get away with stuff, and that's kind of almost the purpose of doing that, you know, for creating the space where you can actually, you know, cause huge damage. And so that is almost like a thing that goes higher and higher and higher. Or so that was one thought. And yeah, it's a good question about this, relating to dance and how I want to use bodies, the actual bodies. And I think, maybe one route of trying to talk about it is that, so my choreographies are always like very, very structured. Like I push this kind of exhaustion almost of a choreography, of a physical task, or this performance that I mentioned earlier of a where I use the salt and then the dancer is floating, kind of like 1.5 meters above ground for 3 hours with like a little bit of help, but you know, but actually she physically it pushed her completely, you know, to the edge. I mean, this was, you know, I didn't force her to do this, but, you know, this was like the collaboration between us. And I think I'm almost like pushing to this moment where a kind of gap opens or where a failure occurs because the body just is not able to be, to create this kind of extreme structure.
Mm-hmm.
So in all my works, also in the work, and only free individual can create a free society, there's several moments where a kind of idea of a collapse happens, where the body's, you know, these long takes also, and then of course some literal collapse of the stage actually collapsing and so on and so forth. But I'm interested in how, and in a lot of my work I did this, including to my own body, I used myself also several times. I had to be, you know, trained with a stunt person and so on, like it was very traumatic. To push, you know, to actually hurt my body almost, but not in this physical theater sense. But and I think, like, because someone asked me once about this idea of how I almost like where my optimism, I guess, is located in relation to the body and in relation to the body and society, and so this was good. Like, so I would say that my optimism is not related in the sense of saying, look, I have this body, I can cut my hand and it will start bleeding and this is awful, like, you know, look what I can do and look at my presence. And I think it's maybe more, this is a bit of an abstract concept that I'm going to say, but like maybe it's a bit more connected to this idea that I can, you know, I have this possibility to create an architecture, which is why I constantly kind of relate to this architecture, where I then throw my own body against it or that of someone else and push it to this edge where then a kind of gap opens. And maybe, like, I think that is the moment of maybe optimism and, you know, in relation to the film of thinking of, like, what can possibly freedom be in a society? Or in the, what he talked about, like, forcing a free society, using violence to create a freer society, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
And of course now we live in a completely different world with ISIS and what do you measure people believing in the killing.
I just think that's such an interesting sort of condition for us to be in, between a kind of normalized acceptance that there is this you know, what we used to call exploitation, so that the work, the bodies, like, or even as what, you know, Jenny was saying about, you know, the sort of bodies, you know, literally eroded by salt in the pursuit of this incredibly, you know, valued commodity. But that's always happened in this region, sort of obviously the legacies of the mining industry, where, you know, there wouldn't be a family in this region whose history didn't get touched by the sort of inbuilt risk and obviously the sacrifice of lives, etc. Whereas now we seem to not see that. So what I thought was a kind of interesting tension in your work about, which was reminded me of the work of, you know, Alan Sekula and other people who've been working on this issue of shipping and, you know, this great, almost as a metaphor for the great networks, you know, of that. And, you know, the men on the ships for months and months and months, and who are the men on the ships? They are people picked up at different ports, who are not being protected by any, you know, labor laws. They are, you know, all of the processes of casualization and immiseration of labor. And yet at the same time, our minds are filled with a certain kind of violence, not with this daily, mundane, structural.
Mm.
So I'm just wondering whether people are, you know, beginning to see how the relationship between the set of concerns you outlined at the beginning and then the very specific set of procedures, you know, that this is not that X will be represented by Y.
No.
But it's actually one of the issues then when you go to an exhibition and encounter your work, that relationship between what you're thinking about and what you're forming. So I'm going to push it to this question of this relationship between the thought and the form and the thought form. How do you, you know, explore, maybe explore a little bit more, why did you come to dance? Why to choreography? Why to filming both of them? right? So there's there are obviously live performances and film performances, but it's that thing about why those procedures in relation to those concerns, which are, I think, very deep and probing.
I think I can explain it best, I think, with movement, actually, with how the development of dance happened. And so, so my initial thought of using everything, including speech, costumes, language, and so on, was the idea that nothing is neutral. So, how I sit here now is not neutral. But when I think, okay, let's say walking is not neutral because it's gendered, it's classes, and so on and so forth. But then even the tiniest movement of my hand can also not be neutral. So I kind of broke it all down to every element. So every word I say is not neutral because you can hear like an accent, you can hear a dialect and so on and so forth, and a grain of the voice and so on and so forth. So that was kind of the beginning of the structure, taking a system apart in general, and then specifically, let's say, in the 60s, this idea of freedom and a freer society and hierarchies and so on and so forth. So, and the other thing is that I wanted to put all these elements equal next to each other, as equal as possible next to each other, so that not the narrative, the spoken narrative, is like the first violin, you know, and the other elements kind of support that through, let's say, I walk from A to B in the performance because I want to illustrate that I'm, you know, picking something up, putting it there, maybe I pick up a suitcase and it implies that I'm going to travel and that's part of the narrative or something. And instead, what I want to do is that the walking becomes a material itself. So when I started to work with movement, I would say to the people, to the performers, okay, like lift your right leg up and then put it forward, 5-10 centimeters, then lower it down again. And while you do that, which is a step then, so but I kind of broke it down and then saying, okay, while you do that, focus like intensely of how that feels in the rest of your body. So like in your cheeks, on your forehead, and your shoulders, and so on and so forth. So the attempt was to really turn it into material in the thing itself, and looking what happens then if it's the thing in itself rather than because that, in a way I tried to eliminate different implications, which I now try to use a voice for. Taking is it possible to take away gender, class, and so on and so forth? And so I tried to do this with every single element almost of the work. And then not with an attempt to arrive at neutrality, which is, for me, not possible, this concept. And also, I'm not optimistic enough, you know. So it's, but what can happen when I do that? Like, is there, and what is in the relationship also to the viewer? You watch it and then, the movements don't illustrate the words, but then sometimes they do because you want them to. You know, sometimes there's a costume in Tenet, for example. I don't know if you saw that previous, before that film, 2010 or 11, where then I had a paper costume and I was wearing this paper costume and I spoke about this vase, and then someone pushed me against the wall. That was my pushing against the wall scenario, and then it gets all destroyed and. Everybody read it as this costume representing a vase, you know, because I was speaking about a vase, and I kind of liked it that it became a vase, you know. But so these connections, of course, they come from conventions of seeing, of looking at cultural productions, of looking at films, looking at all these conventions which are full of hierarchies, full of problems, full of gender, and full of money. So the movement basically, and all, everything became very, very specific. And I said, you know, think about which kind of materials, how they move, how much they weigh, how much they weigh in relation to the body. So I use like aluminium, I use wood, I use different materials on the bodies also for movement. And so then I realized that really only dancers understand, you know, when I talk about this very detailed way of moving, or I say, do exactly what you just did, but create, you know, have more tension in your chest because I wanted to have it more focused on kind of on the middle of the body. And then they do exactly the same movement and focus more on the chest, and it looks completely different. You know, it's like magic for me. So, and before dancers understand that, like they understand me. If, you know, it's so then it kind of happened then very like and kind of almost well, how do you, I don't want to use natural, but like it happened very smoothly that I then looked, you know, also looked at dance, and then I started to look at the whole dance history and, you know, what these movements mean. So, and also looked at this whole history of, so that's why I use ballet, is because, or I use a very elementary way of ballet, is because it describes very strict lines. And there's like a, now, you know, years and years, like centuries of attempts by the dance world to trying to break that line, you know, either in Germany there was a long history, also in the 60s, history of like connecting the body to the elements, connecting to the ground, and and then also this whole idea of improvisation, which is, okay, I make a movement because I feel like it, I respond to something, and that therefore it's freer. I don't think so, because I don't think this movement comes from freedom, it comes from all kinds of restrictions. So I'm quite interested in this whole history of trying to attempt to break the line. So I also attempt to break the line, but not just through movement, but like I use costumes, I use speech and so on and so forth. So the movement I use, you know, it's almost like displaying a structure and then trying to break it.
Mm-hmm. I'm just going to pick up on that, because I think that just as a kind of background maybe for different people in the audience, okay, so that what flashed up into my mind, and this is very, my being an art historian, was Duchamp's painting of the new descending a staircase, you know, the sort of the whole particular sense of the moment in the late 19th century or 20th century when photography changes our perception of the body, because you get chronophotography and you start dissecting through photographic, you know, sequence of photographs taken, but what we don't know. So we can't see the movements of the body, right? We didn't know how horses galloped or even what the mechanism for walking was until Marais and Muybridge, etc., used chronophotography. And once you fragment it, it then becomes forensic. We can study it. It's no longer expressionist, it's gestural. So it sort of interrupts a dance on the one hand, and then, you know, throws into the 20th century what happens then when we take those photographs and we run them 24 frames a second through the projector and reconstitute this broken, fragmented body again as an illusion of movement. And at the same time, then you're going to have this huge revolution in dance at the beginning of the 20th century. First, very expressionist, Isadora Duncan and all those sorts of people. And then the big event is obviously in the 1950s and 60s with Trisha Brown and Yvonne Rainer and the Judd Dance Theatre and another conversation where you go back to a kind of, you know, if you watch an Yvonne Rainer dance, you could only do this, thanks so much for coming, ordinary everyday movements that she does, like, you know, walking across the stage as dance, if you are a trained dancer, because you've trained since you were five or six. You have a completely different muscle sensitivity, you know, to the rest of us, etc. So it's really interesting, these moments. And then I was thinking of Pina Bausch and obviously the enormously influential dance theatre that she set up in Wuppertal that must have, I mean, I don't know if she's part of your...
Oh, a lot.
You know, absolutely, absolutely has to be there. So there's another thing of references here, which is another way in to beginning to prepare. What I'm kind of getting was, how do we prepare ourselves to meet your work? Rather than, in a sense, the work being there and telling us and we just extract it, that there is a way in which this question of studying the way that people make their work, you know, is necessary in order for us to join you when you finally put it on the stage, as it were, of an exhibition. Whereas if we just think we go to an exhibition, you know, and we're going to see something straight off, we obviously will get all sorts of responses from different people, from your work, etc. But the depth that comes from having some sense of how you're formulating it with this very complicated history, it seems to me, of the relationship of how we know our bodies, even just as sort of walking, moving, doing. And the other bit of my little imaginary museum now is I was going to think, I put Charlie Chaplin's Modern Times.
Yeah,
you know,
course.
The sort of,
yeah.
this, you know, the film where he's, I don't, you know, the opening of the film where he's on the line. And this whole question of the mechanization of the, this, you know, the tailorization.
Mm.
So there seems to be quite a lot of interesting ways that your work sort of, you know, sparks off.
Mm-hmm.
And then also, you know, condenses it so that if we see the work, and hopefully this will then proceed to the piece that the pavilion will bring, you know, hopefully this audience will have ways to come to it and to think with you as you try to formulate a way of making something in the world that touches on all these really urgent and subtle questions.
I mean, I think you mentioned like very important influences, including Charlie Chaplin, actually, and also Dada Theatre was the other kind of big influence of turning the body into a sculptural object and creating sculpture gestures, which I like the idea a lot of this possibility of a movement being a sculptural gesture, again being a kind of a material thing, and well, I think the I mean, what I attempt a lot and what I kind of always ask when I have exhibitions and so on is, well, I seek a dialogue, basically, like this now. And where you know, different, or I had an exhibition, for example, at the Showroom in London, and then I invited a choreographer because I wanted to explore more, I wanted to kind of be more confronted by someone coming from the dance world and looking at movement and so on. So. Mm-hmm. I guess that's one possibility. You know, that's one possibility to kind of, as you say, prepare. But yeah, I don't know. There's different ways, I guess.
Because it's not. I mean, I just want to stress: it's not a matter of explaining in advance, but actually the having access to some of the processes as to how you think your way towards a work is part of what we're trying to do here. Sort of is open up the ways that when people do meet the work, they're not just, what is this? I have no way in, you know, because I mean, I think it's a big part of it. Are there any comments or questions? I think we're cutting.
But I just want to quickly respond to this because I actually, sorry.
No, okay.
I mean, for me, it's often actually when people are not prepared and look at it and get, like their responses for me are always very surprisingly accurate, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Like they come up with stuff and I was like, my God, you know, and they had no, I know for sure they didn't know my work before, or almost like new ways of like bringing in notions that I didn't even think about before, you know, like, God, this is a really useful word to actually think about. So I'm not sure really how much of all, you know, now I kind of laid out all these different ideas, but how important or how necessary I find it for reading, because I guess what I find, you know, I guess I want to put in most specifically things that I feel are really important to have directly in the work, like a material or something like that. But a lot of this is, you know, a lot of this informs, you know, it basically informs how I create movement or something like that.
Yeah.
You know, it's, I mean, a lot of this is stuff like the strawberry or we care, and like that doesn't even matter, maybe, you know.
Mm.
So it's, yeah.
Both sides. Okay.
No, it's just a very obvious question, mate. It's about meeting the work. I mean, it really whetted my appetite to see this opera and experience, witness this experience. And is the only opportunity going to be at the Istanbul Biennale, or will it be shown in the UK or other places?
Yeah, it will be in several, like, I'm speaking to several institutions, and it will travel to like various galleries and in Berlin, in Glasgow, in Spain. Like it will go. It will be quite a big. Sorry.
In Leeds.
In Leeds, of course. Yeah.
Well.
So yeah, it will be also Leeds. Yeah. So yeah.
Sorry. Yeah. Istanbul and in.
Exactly.
In Leeds. That's
right.
Um, And it depends which form it takes. You know, then if it's the if it's a screening of the film or whether it's a more live part. Okay. Or, yeah.
Yes.
A record. Yeah. Exactly.
Right. I was just going to say that while you were in Chernobyl, well, I was doing some research more locally around the closure of the Kellingwood Colliery, which is one of the last deep coal mines in the UK, which is scheduled to close at the end of the year. And I went on a visit with an artist called Ruth Lyons, who had been working at the Pavilion. And when we went, the whole operation, when we visited the colliery, the whole operation had shut down because there had been a kind of mechanical fault or something. And they were talking to us about just, you know, something that's probably quite obvious, but I wasn't aware of, just how volatile the coal mining environment is, you know, how chemically volatile it is, and how choreographed and how slow everyone's movement is underground, the miners' movement. And the artist Ruth that I've been that I visited with, she'd previously been down a salt mine in Ireland, the salt sea running from Ireland all the way to Eastern Europe. She's now doing a big project along this salt sea. And she, I didn't know, salt mining is called, was referred to as gentleman's mining because it's a very stable environment as opposed to the coal mining one, which is very volatile. And I suppose what my question to Grace from all of this observation is, to what extent does your construction of environment impact upon the movement in your films? And is this partly why you're going to Shetland as quite a volatile environment where you're open, your dancers are going to be open to the elements, basically, on there, aren't they?
Yeah. Are you thinking of a stunt? Yeah. No, basically. I mean, I'm not trying to produce a politically correct work, you know. I'm not trying to make the world better, you know. I'm not trying to blame people and say it's bad what you do, or, you know, it's, and I'm not trying to put the dancers in a safe environment, actually, at all. I'm sorry to say. I'm not trying to do that. No, in fact, I don't believe in safe environments. I think they're dangerous. let me explain it maybe, but, I think I don't want to take that position, you know, of because I think it's a position of authority and I wouldn't feel comfortable in that position. And I guess what I mean with safe environment is that I think capitalism wants people who are not, you know, who are you know, oppressed and so on and so forth, and attacked, which is like loads of different groups of people, to be, you know, not inside, but being like in on maybe on the edge or a bit outside, in an environment that's safe for them and which makes them, you know, more invisible. And I think that's quite dangerous to do, actually. I think capitalism relies on that, and I wouldn't want to do that.
I thought it was interesting, maybe what you were saying about, I mean, that the, again, this was slightly more kind of Krzysztof Bukhargiev kind of an interest in that question, between this, as you say, the volatility of the, you know, of the mine, of the mining, which is like a chemically unstable environment. And I was interested in what you said, that the movements in underground are very slow.
We've been invited back by UK Coal to take an artist underground. I've been trying to kind of organise this, but yeah, it's just the train that we'd have to go through, and then the time it actually takes to go underground, it takes like an hour or something, and then you have to get out to the coal face as well. So everything's just so slow moving still, and everything underground is sort of mechanical and hand operated as well. So it's just this kind of.
Whereas the salt mines are...
be able to tell you better. The salt mines are just the opposite. They're like a very stable environment. But equally, everything is taken down in parts into a salt mine, and you have these kind of vast cavern spaces.
There's one in Cheshire. I love Cheshire. But the salt here is like aggregate, it's poor man's salt, it's like the aggregate salt, it's like bone salt. Whereas if you move further east, which is what Ruth's doing, then you get the table salt,
I don't understand the question, I'm sorry.
Just saying if you ever thought about salt in itself is, it opposes itself in the strongest way, the two components. It's a negative ion and a positive ion. So it's the tension between two really strong opposing forces, and I was wondering if that was something that you could see, is there anything in your work that you think might speak to that, or in your process maybe?
Well, that's why I choose salt, because of that tension, and because of these different connotations and of different relationships it can create. Mm. Yeah.
Especially your use of sound and conductivity about it.
The use of sound?
The use of sound, because the salt conducts electricity and this is about transmission, that was another kind of connection there.
Okay.
Well, that, I think that's a very useful point, because it comes back to why would you want to have alliances when you're making an art exhibition with oceanographers and biochemists and neuroscientists and all these things, that it's not just a sort of, oh, now let's do the material thing when we used to do the conceptual thing, but actually once you investigate through different forms of knowledge what is actually happening in the material world. And then when we look at ourselves as part of it, but then we're also orchestrating it or choreographing it or in almost like the word that keeps coming up when I think about your work is sort of some kind of translation that is this detranslation, you know, that it's not allowing something to go from A to B in a kind of, you know, this is it when one language and stuff, but there is a transness, a trans carrying, you know, you're exploring, which is putting things to their limits, and that requires some knowledge of what actually are the forces that you can play with, and it comes back to what you were saying, pushing bodies to the limits or pushing bodies against structures where you've got mobile forms against structures, that there's a kind of series of interlocking circles between ways of thinking which the scientific approach to knowledge produces about the material world and ways of thinking in other spheres. And I think that what Caroline Christophe Bakalia does is constantly makes me have to rethink against my very conceptual, linguistic, psychoanalytical, structuralist sort of mode of my own formation about what happens when you decenter the mode that you have for thinking and imagine these relays in a non-hierarchical way. So it's not that human thought covers everything, but actually we're in this constant exploration of the social, the material, the physical, the imaginative, the political worlds that we live in by means of different knowledges, and by putting them in some conversation with each other we have a little bit more humility but also might gain different kinds of ways of grasping both, I think, going back to what she said at the beginning, the costs, the traumas, the historical, the difficulties, but also she is a little, I mean, you talked about optimism, about, you know, flourishing life. I mean, that there is a kind of need for us not to be overwhelmed by the negative, but in a sense, hold these two things together. And
yeah.
Go ahead, I'm going to, you have the last word, good.
no, I think that, I think it brings up actually quite an important question of art making, and you know, as in relation to your comment, it's yeah, like what kind of knowledge or what am I in this moment, you know, like of research and so on. Like, I'm not, you know, I'm not a choreographer, I'm not a scientist or a chemist. You know, I'm not a dancer. I'm not a costume designer. I'm not a set designer. I'm not, and so on and so forth. I'm not a composer. You know, but I think that's really, that's a complicated question. But maybe I just kind of mention it briefly that in my practice, I borrow from all these different disciplines, and which is tricky to do, but it's also this idea again of, you know, of authorship and the idea of knowledge, and the idea of, and also maybe in a wider context of a, you know, which, like, is it okay for an artist to do a work about another culture that they're not part of, or another subject, and so on and so forth. Like, there's, and it's, I think it has a lot to do with control and knowledge and how the system is structured, how labor and how work is structured, in, let's say, now in here in capitalism. But I interrupted you, I think.
Well, no, I was just going to liberate everybody for that they might be free for a little brief moment. Anyway, I think we should bring it to an end. We've had a fantastically interesting afternoon. Thank you very much for lending yourselves and your attention to this event. I hope this will be recorded. You can revisit it, and probably through Marlo and Heather, who are the two collaborators on this project as well. They are setting up blogs and Twitters and things that accounts which you can then pass back your comments and your thoughts. You will tell us before we finish what the hashtag is. But this is the end of this one. The next event that Pavilion and the University of Leeds will be done is on May the 20th. It's Wednesday evening, 6 to 8. Look at the Pavilion website or Istanbul and plus Leeds website, which now exists, for information if you'd like to come and join us for that. And then the 3rd and 4th of June, there will also be publicity about that for a chance to talk to another Making With session, talking to Bracha Ettinger, and then reading with Bracha Ettinger on the Thursday afternoon. So I look forward to that, and I hope you will send us any comments or thoughts or reflections. And I just want to thank you very, very much for giving us your Saturday afternoon and being with us to make this event happen.
And Marlo has asked if I could say, please leave your email addresses if you're not, if you haven't submitted by Eventbrite.
And could you just remind us of the two things that...
Hashtag Istanbul and Leeds.
Istanbul and Leeds, all in one word?
Yeah, so you can follow that.
Okay, and the website is...
It's not live yet, we're still preparing it, so the best way would be to make... If you haven't signed up through Eventbrite, which then you would have your emails, of course, please put your name on that list by the door and we'll send out an announcement when it's live.
Okay, so it just leaves me to thank everybody, to thank Steve of Leeds Media Services, if ever you need wonderful filming for your events anyway, who's for today, and to thank Marlo and Heather for their work, and to thank, obviously, collaborating with Jill and Will, and most of all to thank Grace for coming to join us today. So we'll probably all go downstairs and have a cup of tea or a drink, depending on your disposition, so we can carry on in more informal ways. So thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.